In previous videos, we've gone over two different ways to solve the problem of a vibrating string. That is, we're talking about a wave on the interval 0 to L. By a wave, I mean a solution to the wave equation. Second derivative with respect to time is a constant, which we call v squared, times the second derivative with respect to x, with the boundary conditions that the two ends are tacked down. F of 0 and f of L are always 0, no matter what the time is. So one way we solved it was with standing waves. We treated this as, a second derivative of a function was an operator on that function, diagonalized the function, and got a result. And this was the result. Your solution is written as a sum of terms. Each term looks like sine of n pi x over L. That's the spatial part. And then the temporal part, it has a cosine of omega t term and a sine of omega t term. But we also learned to do things with traveling waves. We saw that we could write our solution as a function of x minus vt plus another function of x plus vt. This is a forward traveling wave. This is a backwards traveling wave. And these functions are related, that h2 of s is minus h1 of minus s, and both functions are periodic with period 2l. So, which is right? Is this the solution to the vibrating string, or is this? And of course, the answer is that they're equivalent. They're both right. And we're going to prove that they're both right. And the way we're going to prove them, we're going to need some trig identities, and we're going to have to look at the periodic Fourier series of H. So here are the trig identities. The first trig identity is the addition of angle formula. Cosine of A plus B is cos A cos B minus sine A sine B. Piece of cake. Likewise, cosine of A minus B is the same thing, only with b replaced by minus b. Cosine of minus b is cosine of b. Sine of minus b is minus sine of b. So the end result is we get a plus sign. But now if you take this equation minus this equation and divide by 2, we get that sine of a sine of b is cosine of a minus b minus cosine of a plus b divided by 2. We can do a similar thing with sines. The sine of a plus b is a sum of two terms. The sine of a minus b is the difference of those two terms. If you add these two equations and divide by 2, we get that the sine of a times the cosine of b, sine of a plus b plus sine of a minus b over 2. Now we're going to apply this with a is n pi x over l and b is n pi vt over L. Now remember that our standing waves are sine of A cosine of B and sine of A sine of B. And we know how to turn sine of A sine of B into sum of pieces. We know how to turn sine A cos B into sum of pieces. So if we have a standing wave of the form sine of n pi x over L, sine of n pi vt over L, and I'm going to put in a 2 just for convenience, we can write that as a cosine of a minus b minus cosine of a plus b. This is a minus sign. Okay. Well, that's a forward traveling wave because it's a function only of x minus vt. And that's a backwards traveling wave because it's a function only of x plus vt. So our standing wave is a sum of two traveling waves. Likewise, if we had a sine n pi x over t times cosine n pi vt over 2, it's the same sort of thing, only instead of having a difference of cosines, we have a sum of sines. But still, one term involving x minus vt, that's a forward traveling wave. One term involving x plus vt, that's a backwards traveling wave. So every standing wave is a sum of two traveling waves. And so if you have an infinite sum of traveling waves, infinite sum of standing waves, you express each term here as a sum of traveling waves, and then the whole thing becomes a sum of traveling waves. So if you have a solution of this type, you can always rewrite it as a solution of this type. Now to go the other direction, we need to do some Fourier series. So we need to do a Fourier series for our functions h1 and h2. Now these were periodic functions with period 2L, so we can express them in terms of cosine of 2n pi s over 2L and sine of 2n pi s over 2L. And of course, the 2's cancel. Likewise, h2 of s, you get cosine of n pi s over L, sine of n pi s over L. Now this variable s, it's a dummy variable. It's going to be replaced with x plus vt and x minus vt. So our actual function is h1 of x minus vt plus h2 of x plus vt. And by the way, I call the coefficients here alpha and beta. Usually we call them a and b, but a and b were already taken. So we're calling them alpha and beta. So we get alpha times these cosines. See, this term, you know, alpha n appears in h1, and so it gives you this cosine of n pi over l x minus vt, and it also appeared in h2, and so it gives you this minus cosine of n pi over l x plus vt. And likewise, beta n appears here and here, and so it appears twice as well. But we just figured out things about cosine of a minus b and cosine of a plus b and their difference. Those were exactly the trig identities that we used earlier. Cosine of a minus b minus cosine of a plus b is twice sine a sine b. So this whole expression becomes twice sine of n pi x over l times sine of n pi vt over l. And the sum of the two sines gives us sine a cosine b. So it's exactly the calculation we did before, only in reverse. Before, we were turning these terms into differences in sums of sines and cosines. Now we have the differences in sums of sines and cosines, and we turn it into a product. So you put it all together, and you get sum of sine n pi x over l, 2 beta 2 cosine plus 2 alpha, 2 beta n cosine plus 2 alpha n sine. Those are standing waves. Not only are they standing waves, but the coefficients of the standing waves, which we called an and bn, are exactly the coefficients, the Fourier coefficients of h1 and h2. The only difference is that the alpha contributes to b and the beta contributes to a. An is actually twice beta n, bn is twice alpha n. So we've got these two descriptions of Fourier of waves, either as traveling waves or as standing waves. And the question is, which should you use? And the answer is, it depends on the initial conditions. If your initial conditions are smooth and spread out, then we know that the Fourier series for these functions decays really, really fast. You only need a few terms, and you've got a really good approximation to these functions. So you only need a few standing waves to give you a very good approximation to the solution to your wave equation. On the other hand, if your initial conditions are very sharp, then you would need lots and lots and lots of terms to do things in terms of standing waves. Same thing happens if they're very narrow. And then it's better to use traveling waves. So if your initial conditions, if this was F naught, and if G naught was something similar, say G naught looks like this, nice and smooth and spread out. So this would be F naught, and this is G naught. If those were your initial conditions, you'd be best off using standing waves. But if your initial conditions are a few spikes that are just moving side to side, this is naturally described in terms of traveling waves. You can write this in terms of traveling waves, and you can write this in terms of standing waves, but it doesn't work very well. This really wants to be described with traveling. This really wants to be described with standing.